It's always good to be in the presence of the Lord, to sense His life and His energy and His purpose in our lives. His presence, His power, His purpose, our privilege. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 5, verses 14 through 16, verse chapter 6, verse 1a. If you have in your Bibles, if you haven't highlighted these verses, I'd invite you to do that in your Bibles. We're going to continue a series, this series or kind of series or whatever you want to call it, on maturing, growing, becoming all that Christ wants us to be, looking for those golden nuggets in Scripture that have to do with maturity and what does that mature Christian look like. The writer of Hebrews tells us, starting in verse 11, "But solid food is for the mature who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. Therefore, let us move beyond the elementary teachings about Christ and be taken forward to maturity." Be taken forward to maturity in Jesus. Is it fair for us to assume and talk about this morning that the world around us needs mature believers in Christ? People who can distinguish good from evil, people who can live according to His Word, people who are modeling Christ, who are living for Christ, whose light has become a life, whose life has become a light to the world around them for Jesus Christ. Does the world need that? See, if we can't at first agree to that point, if we've assumed that the world doesn't need that, then really it doesn't matter whether we mature. Somebody say amen. If we believe that the world doesn't need that, then we won't mature. We won't grow. Or we'll pass the buck on to somebody else because it's somebody else's responsibility to mature and grow, but not mine. Yet the Bible tells us that all of us, Christ calls all of us to eventually be transformed into His presence, His power, His purpose, and our privilege. Paul says that we are transformed from glory upon glory to glory upon glory until we become more and more like Christ. Well, the world and the church in general needs believers who are going to be like Christ. Not believers who look and sound and act like the world. The world doesn't need Christians to be like the world. The world needs Christians to be like Jesus. And I believe that that's a process of maturing in the Word, learning how to handle the Word, learning how to live with the Word. And I think today, you know, we've talked about last couple times before I preached on just this idea of one more soul, of winning people to Jesus, the understanding that we have people around us who need to be won to Jesus Christ. Who's going to win them? Who's going to be that person that's going to win them to Christ? Can we agree this morning that the harvest field is around us, but it's a hard field? It's not an easy field to work in. It's a really hard field. And yet there's still the field is there. The harvest is ripe. The harvest is white. There's ready for harvest to be taken in. Who's going to win those people to Jesus? And understand that Jesus hasn't returned yet because those who were supposed to be won to Him have not yet been won. That's His grace and that's His mercy. Then we talked about a couple weeks ago the will of the Father and how the will of the Father plays into my life. Begin to understand the will of the Father for my life. And how that really takes on even the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be the name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. How many of you know that we focus oftentimes His will on heaven and not very often on His will on earth? In fact, I believe that we as Christians have become so heaven-minded, we're so heaven-minded that His will on earth is not being done. Because we're so heaven-focused. And we should be heaven-focused, but can it be out of balance? Is it possible for us to be heaven-focused out of balance? I submit to you it is. who is going to do His will here on earth? I believe mature believers will do His will here on earth. People who have grown up, again, training themselves how to distinguish good from evil by the use of the Word, living holy and righteous lives, becoming a light to their world, wherever their world is, whether that's at General Mills, whether that's in Timbuktu, whether it's in my office, whether it's at the school, whether it's wherever. This idea of His will on earth being done through me, through my life. So establishing that the Lord, the Father, wants to see people saved, establishing that His will here on earth is for people to be saved, saying that His will is to be like heaven here on earth, what is the keys? Well, the next several messages are going to be about keys, key elements to seeing my life mature in the Lord. What are the key elements? What are the key things that I can focus on in my Christian walk with the Lord? Clearly, one of them is the Word of God and understanding the Word of God and living in the Word of God and reading the Word of God and having the Word of God in me. Somebody say amen. Don't show your hands, but I'm just going to ask you a question. How many of you have read the entire Bible from front to back? If you have not read the entire Bible front to back, then you don't know His Word. And you're relying on me to give you His Word. Or somebody else. Whether it be some TV preacher or radio preacher or whatever preacher. The truth is, you need to get the Word inside of you yourself. Because here's what will happen for you. When you begin to really read the Word and allow the Word to come inside of you, God begins to do an amazing thing inside of your life. He begins to point out things to you that He wants you to work on, to deal with, to move into, that you can't get anyplace else. That's part of His presence. So one of the first keys I want to give to you this morning about this idea of maturity is the third part of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Most of us have a very healthy idea or concept of the Father. Most of us. Not all of us. Some of us have a very unhealthy idea about the Father based upon our earthly father, and we need to be healed of that. Our Father in heaven is not our Father on earth. Somebody say amen. And so we need to be healed. Because our Father on earth is an imperfect, sin-filled person. Just like each one of us. Most of us have a relatively healthy idea of Jesus, the Son, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. A lot of us struggle with the Holy Spirit. And what is the Holy Spirit? Well, we can't have the Father and we can't have the Son without the Holy Spirit. So you can't have two without the third. You can't have the Holy Spirit without the Father and the Son. So they are equal parts of equal part of my salvation, my healing, my restoration, my life in Christ. So if I'm living my life in Christ only through the Father and the Son without the Holy Spirit, then I'm only living part of a life in Christ. I'm not living the full life that Christ actually died to give me. And we see clear evidence of that all throughout the New Testament, starting from Matthew all the way through the end of Revelation. So I'm going to present to you an assumption today that I'm going to ask you to either agree to or not agree to. Can we assume today that because of what we see in the New Testament about the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit should be and can be and will be a part of our lives today if we allow it? I didn't hear a whole lot of affirmation there. I heard some affirmation. Because I say to you, the very idea of that is a scary idea for us, right? Most of us love the idea of surrendering to Jesus once for eternity, but very few of us love the idea of surrendering to the Holy Spirit every day. And that's the essence of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is about an everyday life. that I cannot live fully and healthy in Christ without. I can't do it. In fact, I will even submit to you that without the Holy Spirit, my flesh will end up taking over about 99.9% of the time. If you can agree to that, just nod your head. My flesh takes over. How many of you understand that we have a very strong thing in us called flesh? Very strong. And so, without the presence and the power and the purpose of the Holy Spirit in my life, I will not live the way Christ wants me to live. I will live the way I want to live. And the way I want to live may or may not be actually lining up with the will of the Father. In fact, it may only be lining up with my will. What I want, what I desire, what I think, how I want to live. So I believe that the Holy Spirit, especially for those of us who are born again, converted believers / disciples of Jesus Christ, becomes an absolute evident part of a mature believer, someone who is maturing in the Lord. You're seeing that person surrender to the leading and the guiding and the direction of the Holy Spirit. You see them personally, their flesh begin to die, shrivel up, and the Spirit of God begin to reveal itself in everything that they're doing. That's maturity. That's what a mature believer could and can, maybe even should, look like. And I believe those are the believers that the world needs to see. Because when we look at the evidence of the New Testament, we clearly see that there was something dramatically different about the ones who were functioning in that way. And I'm just going to point out to you just quickly this morning four places where that is clearly evident for us in the Bible. The first one is in Matthew chapter 3, ending up in chapter 4, verse 1. I don't know if it's hot in here to you, but it's hot in here to me. Hold on just a second. I'm about to die here. No, we'll just turn this thing off. Somebody say amen. It's the Holy Spirit. Come on now. Well, the Holy Spirit is represented to us in fire. Somebody say amen. That's one of the images of the Holy Spirit, that there's a fire. Matthew chapter 3, Jesus and the Holy Spirit. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. So we understand that from the very beginning of Jesus' ministry here on earth, there was something that he needed that he didn't have up to that point. Understand, Jesus is Father, Son, Holy Spirit. He's all of these things, and yet in his human form, he's beginning his ministry, and there's something he's missing. What is he missing? The Holy Spirit. In his human form, Jesus needs this. Without this, his ministry is not going to be successful. He needs the Holy Spirit to come on him. I want you to hear that word, on him. There's a sense of on, or resting on, or landing on, or covering over him. Now, most of us have read this scripture hundreds, maybe even thousands of times. And we love the image of the dove, and we focus on the dove and all that things. But understand, this is a powerful moment in the life of Jesus. He is changing here. Something is happening in his life. He is no longer the carpenter's son. He is the Son of God. And that delineation was that the lighting of or landing on him of the Holy Spirit took him into a different place that he could not reach up until that point. It's a great image for us. to know that when I am doing ministry in any form, whatever my ministry is that I'm doing, if I'm doing ministry and I'm not doing it under the influence of the Holy Spirit landing on me, then I'm doing it in my strength. I'm doing it in my flesh. Well, that's what Jesus couldn't do. And he knew that. And the Father knew that. And so the Holy Spirit became an integral part of Jesus' life. Again, I don't need you to raise your hands, but this morning, if Jesus needed the Holy Spirit, do we need the Holy Spirit? Can we ignore the Holy Spirit and still be a follower of Jesus? Or a believer? If our Lord and Savior needed that, do we need that? I submit that we do. And I think I can prove that to you in more scripture. Somebody say amen. If you want to do a real great thing, do a Bible study. Do a word study, Bible study. You can go to any reputable online place. You can get in your Bible, look up the word Holy Spirit, and do an in-depth Bible study of the words Holy Spirit. You want to be changed? But you have to open your heart. Second one, Jesus' believers or his/disciples in the Holy Spirit. Again, all of us are familiar with these scriptures. These are not new scriptures for us today, right? Jesus has completed his ministry. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Jesus says in verse 8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Somebody say amen. When will they be witnesses? When they have received the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit has come where? On them. When the Holy Spirit has come on them, they will now become witnesses to their whole world. When the day of Pentecost, chapter 2, verses 1, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like a blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. I've often wondered what it would have been like to be in the upper room that day. People, completely unified. No dissension amongst them. No issues, no problems, no nothing going on between them. All of them completely focused on one thing, Jesus. One of our problems in the modern day church is we can't get to that point. We can't get completely unified. And so the power of the Holy Spirit can't come. We can't get there. For whatever the reasons, we struggle with getting to that place. Because we can't come to an agreement. And yet there's this need for us in the modern day church to have this very thing happen to us. We need this. We need it desperately. The church in general needs this. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to come on us like it came on the disciples, like it came on Jesus. But just so you know, so you're aware that it didn't end there. And there's many philosophies out there, theological philosophies, that would say to us that after the day of Pentecost and after that situation, that's where that all ended. It didn't end there. How do we know? Well, let's turn to Acts chapter 10, verses 39 to 43. Peter's sitting in his upper room having his little nap, and the Lord shows him a vision about a blanket coming down from heaven and all these animals that are in this blanket, and the Lord tells him to get up and eat. Peter says, what? Are you crazy? I'm not eating that snake. I'm not eating that lizard. Those foods defile me. And the Lord shows him the vision again and says, there's somebody coming. They're coming to your door. Go with them. So Peter gets up, and sure enough, these two guys show up at his door, knock, knock, knock. We've been sent here by the Lord. An angel spoke to our master, and you're supposed to come to our house. This is totally against everything that Peter knows to do. I want you to be aware of this. This is completely against every part of who he is as a follower and believer of Jesus, who he is as a Jew, who he is in every aspect of knowing the Lord God Jehovah. To get up and go to a Gentile's house was absolutely unthinkable. Somebody say amen. And yet, Peter goes. And when he goes, he ends up preaching. And here's in verse 39, it says, we are witnesses. He's speaking of himself and all the disciples of everything he did in the country of the Jews in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a cross, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen. But us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead, he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. While Peter was speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. Did you catch that? Not on a couple, or maybe just that one special one, or that particular guy over there in the corner who's really close to God. But the Holy Spirit came on all. On all of them. In other words, his presence ultimately came to his power, which eventually led to his purpose. On all of these people's lives. In that moment, something changed significantly. So not only has Jesus received the Holy Spirit on him, not only did his 12 disciples, actually his 120 believers sitting in the upper room, receive the power of the Holy Spirit on them, now Peter is moving outside of that group into the Gentile realm, and they are also receiving the same power of the Holy Spirit on them. On them. In other words, it changed everything. It impacted this whole family. It's a great story. Read Acts chapter 10. It's a great story about how that entire family and this man's entire household in one day was completely transformed by the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Has your home been transformed by the Holy Spirit? Is your home a place where the presence of the Holy Spirit is so powerful that your whole home is being changed? Every part of your family is being changed. Every person in your family is being changed. Your children and your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren are being changed. By His presence, by His power. See, I believe this Holy Spirit thing is a key element that many of us living in a modern-day church are missing. We're missing this. Lastly, Paul's disciples. So not only has Jesus got the Holy Spirit, his disciples, his believers got the Holy Spirit, his disciple Peter went out and passed off the Holy Spirit. Now Paul, Acts chapter 19, did you know that the book of Acts is actually officially titled the Acts of the Holy Spirit? It's not just entitled Acts. Somebody say amen. When Luke actually wrote the book of Acts, he titled it The Acts of the Holy Spirit. In other words, the entire book is about what we're talking about here today. His presence, His power, His purpose. Our privilege. It's our privilege to get to function in this. Paul, Acts chapter 19. Out on the road, he's out doing his missionary work. He's going from town to town, planting churches and doing all the things that he was doing. While Paul was in Corinth, Paul took the road through the interior and arrived at Ephesus. There he found some disciples and asked them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" They answered, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Ooh, somebody say amen. You guys aren't very excited today. So Paul asked them, "Then what baptism did you receive?" "John's baptism," they replied. Paul said John's baptism was a baptism of repentance. He told the people to believe in one coming after him, that is, in Jesus. On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Do you see the pattern? Let me ask you another question. Do you see the need? Do you see where we, the church, modern day church, have been derailed? Because of this? Because we're not really able to function in His presence fully and completely? I want you to talk about, I want you to hear me. I'm not talking about this little moment here. I'm talking about living fully engulfed in His presence. Living fully engulfed in His power. Living fully engulfed in His purpose. And yet still living my life where I am. That becomes our privilege as believers in Jesus Christ. That becomes our privilege. The interesting thing about this scripture is that, like many of us, we have only heard about the baptism for repentance. We've not really had great biblical teaching about the baptism otherwise. Because it's a safer place, isn't it? And the reason it's a safer place, because of the last few words of this last verse, and when they spoke in tongues and prophesied, and immediately we turn it off. Somebody say amen. Whoa, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Oh, okay, well, you know, I can understand maybe that, you know, Jesus needed the Holy Spirit on him to do the work he needed to do. And, you know, the disciples needed it on him to really get outside that room and do the ministry and spread the church the way it's supposed to be. Or, you know, that those poor folks in, you know, Cornelius' house, you know, they really needed that so that they could, you know, kind of get unified as a family. Whoa, come on now, Pastor Marty. You just freaked me out. I want you to hear what I'm saying here today, and I want you to be really clear about what I'm saying here today. When the baptism of the Holy Spirit comes on me, it is not absolutely, positively, without question or sure that somehow you're going to begin to babble like an idiot. And if the reason I'm not open is because of that fear, then you need to get rid of that fear, because you're not living in the fullness and the power of the Holy Spirit and the fullness and the power of Jesus Christ, because you're afraid of what Jesus might do in you that you can't control. Because we are absolute control freaks. Every one of us in this room is a control freak. We have been raised in a culture that causes us to be control freaks. And when we're not in control, we don't like it. And so to assume, make an assumption, that just because the baptism of the Holy Spirit comes on me, something like this is going to happen is an unhealthy assumption. Now, before you go too far that way, I'm going to swing this pendulum over here. Okay, it's not an absolute. Come on, somebody say amen. However, God's able to do anything. All things are possible through Him who loves the Lord. God is absolutely able to take my brain, my body, everything that who I am, that He created me to who I am, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, do things in and through me that are absolutely out of my control. And if I won't go there because I'm afraid or I have to be in control, then I'm not living in His presence. I'm not living in His power. I'm not living in His purpose, and I'm absolutely not being able to function in the privilege it is to literally love and follow Jesus, believe in Jesus in a way that sets everything different. And it's all about fear. Fear of the unknown. Fear of what that could be or is going to be or possibly will be. And we watch TV, and we see this, or we see that, and we're convinced that that's not of God. We're convinced that that's not of God. But I say to you, it could be. It could be exactly what you need to live in His presence, to live in His power, and to live in His purpose. Without it, you will not live in His presence, you will not live in His power, and you will not live in His purpose. You will live in your presence, your power, and your purpose. And your presence, and your power, and your purpose will only take you so far in the kingdom. And you will run smack dab into a wall. And that wall will limit you from going any deeper with Him. Now, I'm going to deal with something that's really important here. I want you to hear my heart. I hope you can hear my heart here this morning. I'm not trying to be harsh or tough, but I do want you to live free. If there are people out there, probably in our past, in our personal past, in other churches, other things that we've seen, other things that we've heard about, other situations where we've watched or been on the sidelines and seen, where people have completely mishandled what we're talking about here today. Is that true? People in their flesh have completely mishandled everything that we're talking about here today. And people have gotten hurt. Agreeable? And so because of that, we just say, ugh, it's better that we just don't even go there. Be careful that you don't live your life in Jesus based upon what has happened to somebody else. Be careful that you don't live your Christian faith based upon some philosophy or doctrine that someone else has given to you that does not line up with this word. Be careful that you don't put yourself in a box where you're only able to live in such a place with Jesus that is not total and complete freedom. Distinguish between good and evil. Somebody say amen. The mature believer trains themselves up by the use of the word to distinguish between good and evil. And if I'm struggling with that, then here's your answer right here. It's right here. You're not going to find it in the world. And you're not going to find it on the internet. You're not going to find it in videos. You're not going to find it some easy form, easy thing that just allows me to kind of come and go as I please. You're going to have to train yourself in the Word so you can distinguish between good and evil. Thus live according to His presence, His power, His purpose. It's a key element for us in maturing in Jesus. What are some thoughts that Jesus has about the Holy Spirit? Well, turn with me to Matthew chapter 12. Matthew records Jesus' teaching here. And before I read, I just want to, again, caution you about, be open to what the Spirit, Lord is saying to you through the Spirit here. Don't become offended. Just listen. Listen to what Jesus is saying here. Let your heart hear Him. And so I tell you, every kind of sin and slander can be forgiven, but blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven. Anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven, but anyone who speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven, either in this age or the age to come. Either in this age or the age to come. Now, blasphemy is literally, I'm speaking against the Holy Spirit. It's the rejection of Jesus. It's the rejection of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I'm fully rejecting the Holy Spirit, which means I'm fully rejecting the Father and the Son. Because they are one. Equal parts, equally involved. Those are powerful words for us to get a hold of. To begin to speak against the Holy Spirit is a very powerful thing. I confess to you that there were times in my life that I was like exactly in that place. Lord, I don't want that. That freaks me out. So be careful with that. Be aware of that. Let your heart be opened to what Jesus is speaking into you just by using these verses. John chapter 14 and John chapter 16, both of these verses, 14 verse 26 and 16 verse 13. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. Somebody say amen. Who sent the Holy Spirit? In whose name did He send Him? Did you catch that? But the Advocate, the one whom the Father will send in my name, will. Underline that word will. It doesn't say maybe. He says will. Will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. But when He, the Spirit of truth, comes, He will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on His own. He will speak only what He hears, and He will tell you what is yet to come. Somebody say amen. He will only speak to us what He hears from who? The Father. How many of you want to hear from the Father? Are you open to hearing it through the Holy Spirit? Because if you want to hear from the Father, the Holy Spirit's going to be involved. Some would even, theologically, if you look these verses up, some theologians would even say that the only way you're going to hear from the Father is through the Holy Spirit, because the Father's not speaking to you anymore because He sent the Holy Spirit to speak for Him. So if I'm not open to the Holy Spirit, I potentially may not even be able to hear from the Father. Somebody say amen. So there's a problem here. If I'm not open to the Holy Spirit, then maybe I'm not even able to hear from the Father. Maybe I'm praying, Father, 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 and the Father is not answering because He's trying to speak to me through the Holy Spirit, and I'm not open to the Holy Spirit, so I can't hear from the Father. He says He's my advocate. He's my teacher. He's going to guide me. He's never going to speak on His own. He will only speak what He hears. And He will then tell me what is yet to come. Ooh, come on. That means the Holy Spirit is prophetic in nature. That means He could actually speak to me prophetically in things that I don't even realize are going to happen yet, but they can open up for me as I'm open to Him. How many of us, don't raise your hands, how many of us want to know what God wants to do in our lives? How many of us are praying, Father, what are You going to do in my life? And He's trying to send the Holy Spirit to speak to me through His Word, through some other form. And I'm not listening because I'm waiting for the Father to light up the sky and tell me some magic thing, write something on the wall or whatever. And I'm missing it. Because I'm so in tune to only Father and Son that I'm totally shut off the voice that I need to hear. My teacher, my guide, my advocate. The person who's trying to tell me exactly what the Father wants in my life. And I can't hear. I invite you to just look at those two sets of scriptures this week. Spend some time in Matthew chapter 12. Spend some time in John. Read those two scriptures. Ponder those scriptures. Let the Lord, let the Holy Spirit speak to you about your life. Ask Him, Lord, what is it You're trying to tell me that I can't hear? Holy Spirit, speak to me. Invite the Holy Spirit to speak to you. Get a pad and pencil when you're ready. Have a piece of paper handy. Because some of us may have blocked that for so long that he's got a whole truckload of things He wants to download to us that we haven't been able to listen to because we're listening to the wrong person. Because we've turned it off, because we're afraid of what might happen if we let that happen. I'm convinced. I've become very convinced of something for our modern day culture, and it really, and especially for us in the church, that we, the church, individually, corporately, all of us coming together, but individually. Because I hear this all the time. What does God want to do in my life? What does God want to use me for? What's God want to make happen in my life? But all this stuff, it's always there. People are wanting that. I'm going to give you a golden nugget today. I believe we, as the Church of Jesus Christ in general, but also we individually inside the Church of Jesus Christ, every one of us needs a word from the Lord. We need a word from the Lord for our life. We don't necessarily need anymore a word from other people. What we need is a revelation from the Father and the Son and through the Holy Spirit to transform and change the direction of my life. Because preachers are preaching and nothing's happening. What we need is God Himself through the Holy Spirit to break into my life and give me a word. Because here's the thing that happens when we get a word from the Lord, there ain't no denying it. But that's also why many people don't want that. I don't know if I want a word from the Lord, Pastor Marty. Because that might mean I might have to. Say this with me. All of us together. I hate change. True or false? There's not a one of us in this room who doesn't hate change. We absolutely despise it, especially change that I'm not sure what it's going to look like on the other side. And that's the only kind of change that Jesus brings into my life. Jesus never gives me the whole picture. Amen? Jesus gives me step one. When I do step one, He gives me step two. When I do step two, He gives me step three. And until I do step one, two, and three, He's not given me four. Well, that's not how we live in this culture, is it? We plan everything to the minutest detail. From baking a cake, to taking a vacation, to an education, to a career, to a family, to a home. We plan everything. Jesus is our travel planner. If we're open to the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit is our person sitting at the travel booth with the computer, typing out my information. Oh, you want to go to Cancun? Oh, here's what you have to do. He's my travel agent. But we want the whole plan. He won't give it to us. I'm just going to be honest with you. If you're looking for Jesus to give you the whole plan, you're never going to get it. Because He's not going to give it to you. He's going to give you the first step. And then the rest is up to you. Listening to the Holy Spirit, following the Holy Spirit, allowing the Holy Spirit to lead me. It's a key for maturing in the Lord. For maturing in the Lord. It is rarely, if ever, about my plan. It is always about His plan. His presence, His power, His purpose, our privilege. When we get in line with the first three, it becomes a privilege to serve Jesus. It becomes a privilege to live that life. Every day it becomes a privilege of being in His presence and seeing His power and understanding His purpose is being fulfilled. His kingdom is being grown. His light is being shown. He is using me through those things. As the worship team comes, I invite you to really think that through for yourself. I'm going to read one more set of verses as they come. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 21 to 25. These are verses that we've used over and over in this series. And it's a picture for us of those mature believers, that mature follower, that mature person, disciple of Jesus Christ. Paul's writing to 2 to Timothy. Timothy was Paul's disciple. He was one of those guys that Paul invested in his whole life. He trained him up. He raised him up. He was an evangelist for him. He prayed for him. He laid hands on him. The Holy Spirit came on Timothy. All those things were part of Paul's activity in Timothy's life. Paul writes, he says, "Those who cleanse themselves from the latter will be instruments for special purposes, made holy, useful to the master, and prepared to do any good work. Flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Don't have anything to do with foolish and stupid arguments, because you know they produce quarrels, and the Lord's servants must not be quarrelsome, but must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Opponents must be gently instructed in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. Seek and save the lost." That's the mature believer's lifestyle right there. They have set aside themselves from the latter life. They've become instruments for special purposes. They've been made holy, useful to the Master for good work, for His kingdom. That's a mature believer. That's a mature believer. As your pastor, maybe I'm fool enough to believe or silly enough to believe that in some form, in some place, in every life, who's a believer and disciple of Jesus Christ, in some form, somewhere in my life, in some element, that comes true. As we are engaged with Christ, that comes true. I become that person in some form. No longer a spectator in the church, but a participant of the church. No longer just sitting around and watching everybody else do it, but I'm engaged and I'm involved and I'm being useful and I'm being as well. That's maturing. You know, the first part of Hebrews we read, you know, talks about you're still an infant. You're still living on milk, and you know, we got to teach you the truth all over again. There's this place for us of accepting that responsibility for some growth, becoming what He wants. And maybe I'm silly to believe that that's possible, but I believe it. I believe that's the power of Jesus Christ. When He comes into our life, that's His power. That's what He does. But I believe we have to accept it as well. And we have to be willing as well. No man can, Jesus is never going to force Himself on any person. We have to be open to that. So I invite you right now to bow your heads. I would even invite you at this moment right here just to raise your hands to the Lord in some form, some way, however you would feel led of the Lord to do that this morning. Because what I believe this morning is that the Lord wants to do something pretty powerful in this room through the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. He wants to begin to do something pretty amazing in each life here in this room. I think He wanted to use this message to bring us to a place of at least looking to see where it is that I need to make a change here when it comes to the Holy Spirit, and to ask myself some questions. Am I really open to the Spirit of God? Am I really open to the Holy Spirit? Or have I blocked that? Have I cut that off out of fear and trepidation, out of uncertainty, or being unwilling to risk what it might look like on the other side? Am I fearful? Am I fearful? And would the Holy Spirit want to do something very amazing here in my life? Would He want to change course in my life and open up a channel to me that has been very much closed? And the reality is, I'm the one who's closed it. So I invite you this morning, as the worship team begins, invite the Holy Spirit to come on you this morning. One of the things we teach at the retreat is that if you want the Holy Spirit to come on you, you first have to desire it. So you have to desire to have the Holy Spirit come on you. If you don't desire it, it's not going to happen. You have to desire it. The Scripture has come to the place where you believe in the Scripture and you see that it's necessary and you need it in your life. Once you desire it, you have to believe that it's possible. You have to believe that the Holy Spirit can actually come into your life in a powerful way. Once you believe, then all you have to do is ask. Because what I believe is my faith, and my faith then opens the door, and my faith is then what allows the Holy Spirit to come and begin to move on me in some significant way. And then the rest of it is up to the Lord and you. You decide at that point. You know, if the Lord decides to do something in your life, hallelujah, and you receive that and you're free in that. Or I don't know. It's not for me or for anyone else to say. It's about us being just open. First, desiring. Second, believing. Third, ask. Would you ask? Will you invite from your heart today the Holy Spirit to come on you? To allow Him to begin to really come on your life. And even take you to places that you've never been yet. Never been so far. I pray that today you will open your spirit. You will open your life. As the music begins, and if you want to come forward and people to pray for you, we can pray for you. That's okay, but it's really going to be about that. I desire, I believe, and I ask. And then God does the rest. The Father sends the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit comes and speaks into your life, and an amazing thing takes place. An amazing thing takes place. And I believe with all of my heart, that's what every one of us need to live effectively in this Christian age. We need the presence and the power. We need His purpose of the Holy Spirit to live that life of privilege in Him. I invite you to stand. Let's just pray together. Raise your hands. Begin to receive the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Lord Jesus, we thank You today for Your truth and Your word. We thank You for Your life. We thank You for showing us through Scripture where there is a need in our life for this very evidence of Your Holy Spirit to come and change us and transform us and fill us and speak into us. Lord, we admit today that some of us in this room are fearful because we're not sure what that looks like. And we are absolute control freaks. And so, Lord, we just release control. We release our control into Your hands today because You are trustworthy. Lord, we do not see You, Father. We don't see You as a father as our earthly fathers are. Lord Jesus, we don't see You as a brother as our earthly brothers are. Holy Spirit, we invite You to come and do something in our lives. Open that door. We open that door to You. Holy Spirit, we invite You to come. Minister to us. Maybe there's someone here in this room who needs to be accept Jesus as Lord and Savior of your life. Let the Holy Spirit minister to you right now. Maybe there's someone in this room who the Lord's been calling for a long time into a ministry. You've closed that door. Let the Holy Spirit open that door. Let the Holy Spirit minister to your life to give you confidence to do the things that He's asked you to do. Maybe there's someone in this room who needs healing in some form. Let the Holy Spirit come. Emotional, spiritual, physical, mental healing. Let the Holy Spirit come and begin to minister into your life. Let Him show you that healing. Let Him reveal it to you. Lord Jesus, we want a word from You today. From this point on in the service, we want a word from You. We invite You, Jesus, to come. We love You. We love You. Amen.